And may the words of our mouths and may the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our salvation. Bless us here and now that we ponder your word. Bless us that we hear your voice calling us anew. Make us to be who we really are meant to be. In Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. So I grew up in Long Island, New York, and I grew up in a small town of about 200 some odd thousand people. And we weren't a small town at all. We thought we were the country because we weren't New York City. We were really just an extension, really. But back then, we grew up, we thought it was a big deal. We had an eighth of an acre for a yard. In fact, we had this row of homes, and all of them had been built about the same time. They were all exactly the same, and we all had the same size yard. And this was the early 70s. We didn't actually put up fences yet. And so as kids in the summertime, we would just run from one yard to the other. It was as if it was all part of one yard. And the other great part was we had this piece of property right next to our house, which had never been developed. So what happened instead was it kind of washed away. So we had this gully, which was just this hole in the ground. And as kids, we thought the hole in the ground was the greatest thing in the world. So as kids in the summertime, we would be out and we'd play and we would go out and stay out as long as we possibly could. And so in those days, it would eventually get to be about twilight. And that's when the parents started calling people in. And the thing that I loved was that my father always got home late in those days, and my mother did too. And as a result, we were always the last family in the neighborhood to eat, which meant that as my friends got called in, I always knew that I would be there till the end. I didn't want to miss anything. So it was great. You know, I got to stay. And finally, it would roll around that I was the last one called. And my parents would call and I would go. And that would be it for the night. I was called in and that was okay. At least I was the last one. Mm-hmm. So Janyce, when you were growing up, you had a very different place to grow up, but what was it like?
Yeah, I grew up in what was really a small town, about 4,000 people in Southwest Pennsylvania. And our home was actually on the last street of the town, which as a kid, that was pretty cool because what was beyond our street was this quarry. And at this quarry was a little pond. So that was a place we could go and catch tadpoles and do things like that. We also had a playground with basketball courts at the elementary school, which was walking distance from my house. We had two pieces of property, one at my old grandparents' house across the alley and one beside our house that wasn't developed. So a lot would go on there. We also had ball fields, softball and baseball fields, that were right up the hill from where I lived. So I could be any one of those places and would be doing all sorts of things, maybe catching lightning bugs into the evening. That was my favorite thing to do. And then I would get the call. I would hear my name either out of the front porch or the back porch, whichever my parents thought they had the best chance of getting hold of me. And I'd hear it once, Janyce. Time to come home. And then I hear it another time. And then when I heard it the third time, it would be, Janyce, this is the third time. Now come home.
And so you heard the first two times?
Absolutely. Yeah, I did.
You did. And so was your secret to life pretending that you didn't hear?
It was. And maybe it got to the point where they expected that they'd have to do it three times. And that was okay.
So I wonder, you know, that was one of the great parts of growing up in the 70s. You know, we just sort of, we do our thing and somehow we manage to survive childhood. And I wonder what it was like for other folks. And if you wanted, you could share on Facebook Live what it was like when your parents called you home, or even if you're still at the age where your parents call you home, what is it like today? And And how many times do they have to call? And I'll add, it is a common story.
It is. It's common, these types of stories that when we were growing up, we had a common experience.
Yeah, and our parents may have had different ways of calling us home.
But one thing was certain, we always knew their voice, didn't we?
We did. And my mother died in 1977, but I will share that to this day, I remember her voice. I remember her voice even better than what she looked like. And I will add, her voice was the first voice I ever heard. I was in the womb, and it was a voice that indeed sang to me at night and called me in at night, and a voice that I remember to this day.
And as people of God, we also need to remember that there are voices that we listen to. There are the voices that will shape our hearts, maybe in more ways than we can even imagine.
And the voices we listen to, and we all have voices we listen to, and they may be the voices of family, they may be voices of media. It could be the voices we hear in worship today. The voices we listen to will in many ways remind us of who we are and whose we are.
And that brings us to our gospel reading today from the 10th chapter of John.
And I will add, and this sounds awfully obvious, but John chapter 10 follows immediately after John chapter 9.
And here's what happens in John chapter 9. Jesus heals a man who had been blind since birth.
And if you read it, it actually takes Jesus two whole verses to heal the man.
And most of the rest of the chapter then is centered on how Jesus' followers or those who were present that day respond to the healing.
And for the most part, actually, people do not come to faith because of the healing.
In fact, most people reject Jesus rather than following him.
So if you're reading the story, this is all part of one story. So immediately after Jesus has been rejected by the religious leaders,
and also the crowds,
he begins to teach anew.
He describes himself as the good shepherd.
He lays down his life for the sheep.
He lays down his life for all of us.
And Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me."
And he also says that he goes ahead of them, and they follow him because they know his voice.
And I want us to remember that Jesus is not just talking to his disciples of long ago and far away.
No, he's speaking to all of us, even today.
And Jesus says this to you. Jesus says, "I am your good shepherd."
And Jesus says, "I know you, and you follow me."
Jesus says, "I give you eternal life.
And you will never perish."
And Jesus says, "No one will snatch you out of my hand.
Because I and the Father are one."
And in Jesus' words today, we have an invitation.
An invitation to follow him.
An invitation to trust in him always.
So Jesus is speaking to us in the midst of this season.
And Jesus assures us that we are safe in his care. And no matter what the future may bring, you are safe in Jesus' care today.
Jesus continues to speak to us.
Jesus calls us by name.
Jesus calls you by name.
Jesus knows who you are.
Jesus loves you more than words can say.
And we today, you and I, we are called to listen for his voice calling us today.
And we learn to recognize his voice whenever we gather in worship.
And whenever we pray.
And whenever we read and we study the scriptures.
Jesus is always speaking to us, always speaking to you.
And Jesus is always calling us.
And we really do need to practice listening for Jesus' voice.
But you know, Even the more faithful among us will at times struggle to hear God's voice.
Even the most faithful among us will struggle. All of us will. And that is why we need each other.
Yeah. We're not meant to be alone in this faith journey.
And we may not like to be compared to sheep.
But if Jesus is our shepherd,
then we really are part of his flock.
And when you struggle to hear his voice,
then you need to also remember that we have one another.
And part of why we are members of this church, that we are church together, is that we help one another to listen for Jesus' voice together.
And none of us is meant to make it alone. We might not be able to see each other face to face. We might not be able to gather in person. But you know, this is a real gathering right here, right now. We are gathered. This is real worship. And you are there. We are here. But Jesus is with all of us. And none of us is alone, really. Jesus is with us. And we started out today talking about how our parents called us home and how some parents are still calling their children home. Mm-hmm. And it reminds me of a story by the former New York Times reporter, Dennis Covington. And he tells of his own childhood growing up in rural Alabama.
And in his neighborhood, like so many others, parents would call their children home for dinner.
And this is what he writes of his own experience. And he says, most of the children in my neighborhood were called home for supper by their mothers. They would open the back doors, they would wipe their hands on their aprons, and they would yell, Willie or Joe or Ray. Either that or they would use a bell bolted to the door frame and ring it loud enough to start the dogs barking in backyards all along the street. But I was always called home by my father. And he didn't do it in the customary way. He walked down the alley all the way to the lake. And if I was close, I would hear his voice on the gravel before he came into sight. And if I was far, I would see him across the surface of the water, emerging out of the shadows and into the gray light. He would stand with his hands in the pockets of his windbreaker while he looked for me. And this is how he got me to come home. He always came to the place where I was before he called my name.
And that is exactly what Jesus promises to do for each and every one of us.
That Jesus always comes to the place where we are before he calls our name. And there will come a day. Jesus calls us today to be his own, but there will come a day when Jesus will also call us to come home with him.
And he will not wait for us to come to him.
Instead, he will come to us. He will come to you.
And he will meet each and every one of us wherever we are.
And he will meet us and accept us as we are.
And Jesus will stand before us.
And he will speak our name. He will speak your name.
And Jesus will bring us home.
He will bring you home. Thanks be to God.
Amen.